Shortly after taking office, Governor Kay Ivey eliminated the RCO system, looking for another solution. So what solution would you propose to fix Medicaid, and how would you pay for it?
I don't think that Dr. Bentley was far off the mark. You know, having a regional organization may save cost, and it may help, you know, with the quality of coverage. But the problem with both Governor Bentley and Governor Ivey is you've got to fund it. Alabama has the leanest, meanest Medicaid program in the nation. No nation offers lower benefits and lower eligibility than Alabama. And what people don't understand is that right now in Alabama, 74% of our community hospitals are operating at a deficit. They're running the hospital in the red. One hospital administrator told me that Medicaid is only paying 53% of their actual cost. Well, nobody can run a business that way. So what we've got to do is basically tell the people of Alabama what is the real truth. And the real truth is that Medicaid is not just for poor people. Medicaid is not just for economically disadvantaged people. Medicaid provides access to health care for us all. So if we do not bolster Medicaid, if we do not get a growth tax into the general fund to bolster Medicaid, we could lose 20 or 30% of our community hospitals. And then for urban areas like here in Birmingham, you will be in extremely difficult predicament trying to find a bed because people from out in the counties will be coming into the urban hospitals. This is going to be bad for our rural counties, and it's going to be bad for the citizens in our urban cities like Birmingham.
Rural health care is another big issue here in Alabama. In a recent Washington Post article, Alabama was singled out as ground zero for what is wrong with rural health care. Only half of the rural hospitals can deliver babies. The state has the highest infant mortality rate and the highest number of diabetics. So what is your plan to bolster rural health care, and how would you pay for that?
Well, I'm from Evergreen, Alabama. I mean, that's my home. And the fact that the Evergreen Hospital is one of the hospitals that's operating in the red is of significant importance to me. Because once you lose a rural hospital, the doctors leave, industry won't come, and then literally we'll be relegated to poor people and the elderly without public transportation and no access to health care. So we've got to expand Medicaid. As I mentioned earlier, Alabama has the lowest eligibility requirements of any state in the nation. That hurts us all. So we've got to expand Medicaid. We have to do it. Now, public health. Public health has an important impact on economically disadvantaged citizens and others. But our public health department has not been appropriately funded either. Yet again, it's another situation with the general fund. Our general fund is hurting. I mean, it's truly hurting. And it's time for the Alabama legislature to really tell people what they should hear and not what they want to hear. And that is that there's certain things that have to be funded, and health care is one of them. You know, infant mortality is a huge problem. And that's an issue of education, you know, as well as, you know, providing access to health care.
Another issue is there was a recent WalletHub.com report, Alabama tied for the smallest gap in bachelor's degrees between men and women, but it had the fourth largest pay gap between genders. So what would your plan be to improve pay equity between men and women?
I'm so glad you mentioned that, because that's one of our big issues in Alabama. Also a significant issue is the fact that Alabama is fourth in the nation in our percentage of citizens who make minimum wage. The average wage on those who are receiving minimum wage is 35. So a lot of those are women with children. So we want folks to get out and work, but we can't really expect them to support themselves or their family on $7.25. But the gap, we've got to address it, and we need to put attention on it. And I'm definitely the governor that will do that. It's wrong for there, if a woman is doing the same job, has the same responsibilities, and in many cases, we have women that actually have more experience, have worked at a place longer, but because of the old conventional view, well, a man is the breadwinner, they would literally pay younger men with less experience more. That's got to stop. That's got to stop. We've got to pay attention on it. We've got to work with the chambers. We've got to work with business. And I would certainly look into the possibility of legislation.
What do you think in terms of a timetable? How long do you think it would take to level the playing field?
I think it would take a while. I mean, and that's not a very exact answer. But it's got to be done because it's families that are suffering because of it. My first effort as governor is going to be focusing on what I'm calling the lifelong learner lottery. And so that's going to be my first initiative. And once we can get the lottery passed, and we can, we're going to also work on infrastructure. Once we do that, then I'm going to be looking at other issues like the overcrowded prison system, you know, expansion of Medicaid and other things that we've got to do to be able to take care of our people.
Infrastructure is another big issue, and the president's current plan to repair and improve infrastructure depends heavily on state matching funds. Mm-hmm. Over the years, the legislature has not been inclined to create revenue streams to provide such funds. So first question is infrastructure repair on your list of priorities?
It is at the top of my list. Infrastructure repair and expansion is at the top of my list. Alabama is being left in the dust by our surrounding southern states. While we have a road or state highway that will get to the state line, and then it's four lane. You know, we ought to be able to do that. We cannot do it because Alabama's fuel tax has not been elevated in a quarter of a century. Let me say that one more time. Alabama's fuel tax has not been elevated in over a quarter of a century. People are supporting the notion that we've got to do something about our roads and bridges. 20% of our roads and bridges have been determined to be obsolete. We have got significant issues that it, not just safety, but it's economic development. When people are, right now the average cost per car or individual on the roads is around $140 of extra repairs to a car because of the poor maintenance of our highways. Right now in Alabama, county commissions are evaluating which roads to dig up and put back to dirt. I mean, do we really want to be known as the state that creates more dirt roads than paved roads? I don't think so. So I am going to take the bold, and some people would say it's not necessarily that politically smart, but you know, the time for political and politicking is really over, and political posturing is over. It's one thing for any of the gubernatorial candidates to say they're for infrastructure. They've got to say how they're going to pay for it. I'm going to be offering a modest but adequate tax on fuel. We're going to look at the possibility of how to craft and save a small portion of that money to be able to send it back to those who are on the low income levels and who are commuting. I was talking to a wonderful woman, mother of three, of a three-year-old, and she said that she drives 50 miles one way to get to her job in Mercedes. You know, she's making $15 an hour working for a contractor. She drops her child off at 4:30 in the morning, you know, to get to work. Those are the kind of things we've got to start removing some of the obstacles. And so we don't want the fuel tax to hurt someone like her. So I do think that there's an innovative way to try to create a fund for those that are on the lower income scale and are commuting long distances for them to receive some type of reimbursement.
Immigration is another topic that is talked about a lot recently. President Trump wrote a wave of support on his border wall plan on the way to the White House. Alabama was a state that led the way in that support. But in the beginning of his term, the plan has kind of undergone some changes from not proving that Mexico, to have Mexico pay for it, to the barrier the Dream Act has created in Congress. So the first question is, what is your stance on the border wall?
Immigration is a federal issue. I mean, it is. Immigration is totally and completely a federal issue. We've got enough problems here in Alabama with infrastructure, you know, with Medicaid, with our education system, you know, with the lack of substance abuse, mental health services, the most overcrowded prison system in the nation, that I'm going to relegate the immigration issues to where they are appropriately left, and that is with Washington, D.C.
Do you think Alabama taxpayers should be paying for the wall?
You know, it's a federal issue. You know, it's a federal issue. And I honestly think that that's one of those decisions that it's going to be up to the congressmen and U.S. senators to decide what to do. I know that we've got a lot of urgent needs. I'm not necessarily sure that that's one of them.
Are you willing to allow children born in Alabama and their families to stay in exchange for a border wall?
Am I willing to? Would you repeat that?
Sure. Are you willing to allow children born in Alabama and their families to stay in exchange for a border wall?
That's a federal issue. That's a federal issue.
Okay. Anything, would you have a different plan or anything with
it's a federal theory? Issue. Okay. I mean, immigration, I've been a judge for 30 years, and there's nothing a state judge can do about immigration. there's nothing that Alabama legislature can do about immigration. Immigration is a federal issue. We've got enough serious challenges in Alabama to focus on those things that we have no control over, and we don't have any control over that. It's a completely federal issue.
Gun rights are another issue that is talked quite a bit about recently. Alabama has long been known as a leading supporter of gun rights in America. The outdoor industry in our state is a multi-billion dollar business. Gun manufacturers have been moving here to build their products. Gun laws, though, were not discussed by state lawmakers, much less proposed. In a recent 24/7 report, Alabama ranks fourth in the number of incidents of gun violence. So in the wake of mass shootings like we saw in Parkland, Florida, and the concert, the outdoor concert in Las Vegas, do you think that Alabama should consider banning some assault weapons?
The issue of guns in Alabama, gun and gun ownership are essential to what a lot of people believe in Alabama is their rightful privilege. Obviously, the Second Amendment, I'm a judge. I've been a judge for 30 years. I believe in the Second Amendment. I myself have been a victim of crime. My house was firebombed when I was a trial court judge in Evergreen, so I understand the importance of having a gun for protection. My family are hunters and fishermen. I myself have hunted. And I truly believe that Alabamians want to be able to hunt. They want to be able to, you know, protect their families, and that's all very well and good. But we've got to begin a meaningful conversation about gun safety. We know that in states that have background checks for everyone has a background check for the purchase of every weapon. We know that they have lower incidences of gun violence. They have lower incidences of death or injury from domestic violence. So certainly we need to begin to seriously look at some of those issues because truly the public is overwhelmingly for certain measures that will help make us all safer.
Do you think that we should, the state should look at banning some assault weapons?
I would think that there, when you talk about banning in Alabama, there's not support with Alabamians, you know, I would think many Alabamians for banning. But looking at age requirements, looking at how old you have to be to own certain weapons is absolutely something that we should be discussing and looking at.
So not necessarily banning automatic weapons, certain automatic weapons, but I guess the next question, you kind of touched on this, should the state consider raising the age of automatic weapons to be purchased?
I agree with that. I absolutely think that we need to look at an age requirement. And I think we need to look at more extensive background checks. The issue, obviously, you know, we know that there's a ready availability of guns. That's something that we could do about, that we could do something about. I'm going to be working on the Lifelong Learner Lottery, and it's going to create revenue that could be used to help increase safety in our schools, as well as perhaps provide some funds for things like gun buybacks and things of that nature that have been shown in other communities, other cities and states to actually reduce gun violence and injury from guns. And so there's other issues, you know, that we need to look at as well.
How should the state handle the issue of mental health and guns?
This is probably one of the biggest challenges. Obviously, that we truly need to take what is considered to be the premier method, you know, for vetting those that are mentally ill, and restrict their ability to own a gun. You can't do that if you don't have background checks. So I hope that we can begin a meaningful conversation on what we can do to increase background checks in Alabama, because that's where, I think everyone agrees that if you're mentally ill, you shouldn't own a gun. You shouldn't possess a gun. But there's no way to enforce that without background checks. So it certainly, I think, goes hand in hand. Having been a judge, I know that our prisons are full of mentally ill people. A lot of people on substance abuse have substance abuse issues. They're there because they are literally self-medicating with drugs and alcohol. Alabama does as little to help with programs and services for the mentally ill as any state in the nation. Everywhere I go, citizens will bring attention to that matter. So we've got to do something on both ends. We've got to do something also about beefing up, adding resources to the local mental health boards, mental health offices, and the services. For instance, a child is abused. Sometimes those children will wait 6 weeks 8 weeks before they'll have access to a counselor that's specialized in dealing with child victims of sexual abuse or physical abuse. That's wrong. We ought to be helping that. We ought to be helping those children, the most vulnerable children, that they did nothing wrong, but yet they've been abused. And then Alabama, by our failure to properly fund mental health, the mental illness issues and services, what we've done is help protect those and help those ameliorate the negative damage of abuse that they've received. If they don't receive counseling, they easily are that group of individuals that will go on to perpetrate some violence themselves.
Another issue is school safety. What is your plan to make schools safe for students?
It's not to arm teachers, I can tell you that. I met with teachers and superintendents last night. All of them very concerned about the recent incident, you know, at Huffman. The teachers, what I gathered from what the teachers and superintendents told me is that they do think that there needs to be additional resources for funding for school safety, but the local school officials want the authority and the autonomy to decide how it should be spent. They don't want the legislature or the governor dictating to them, okay, Hoover, you spend the money this way. Tarrant, you spend the money this way. You know, Gardendale, you spend the money this way. Mountain Brook, you spend it this way. Because not every school's needs are the same. So yet again, we don't have enough money in public education, and we've got to find the resources so that it can be used for that, as well as many other things that impact the wellness and safety of our children.
Do you think that there should be metal detectors in schools?
I'm certainly not opposed to metal detectors, and some superintendents thought that metal detectors would be helpful. The problem that we have is that for a metal detector to be helpful, that means everyone must come in into the school in one entrance, which is certainly doable for sure, but you've got to have at least two trained officers with guns at the metal detector to be able to deal with any issues, you know, of someone that actually is bringing in a weapon, whether it's a knife or a gun or whatever it might be. And the funding for that, you know, is going to be significant. I know that some cities have enough resources that they've already voluntarily come forward, you know, and said we want to add additional officers and, you know, to the school systems. And that's wonderful, but some communities don't. So we've got to find a revenue stream. And yet again, I'm going to be proposing the lifelong learner lottery, and there will be additional resources that could be given to the schools so the schools themselves could decide how they should be spent to do the best job keeping their children and their faculty safe.
The economy is another big issue.
Yes.
Alabama has seen some big wins in business recently. Mm-hmm. The Toyota Mazda plant, yep. The auto car plant, the Huntsville Aerospace Growth, to name a few. Tax incentives were used to bring the major plants to Alabama, but in some cases there were no guarantees that local workers would be used to build the plant. So where do you stand on the use of tax incentives for these companies?
Well, tax incentives are offered by every state. So you can't just say, well, I'm against tax incentives, because that's offered by every state. And we've got to be competitive with other states. But I do think that there needs to be an evaluation, and it needs to be put into every contract, that there'll be an evaluation of how many workers are actually there working in the plant that are residents of Alabama. Right now, with the new industries that are coming to Alabama, unless we find additional resources to fully fund our career tech and workforce development, we do not have the workers to be able to fill those positions. It's my understanding that approximately 100,000 individuals are coming from other states into Alabama who have the skills. And then they're going back and spending their paychecks back in Georgia, back in Tennessee. We've got to fix that. When I'm elected governor, I'm going to be proposing full funding and a way to fully fund career tech and workforce development.
So what do you do to make sure that, or to ensure that money made in Alabama stays in Alabama?
It's unconstitutional and a violation of the Commerce Clause to mandate that a company only hire Alabamians. If you could do it, believe me, I would do it, but it's unconstitutional. You cannot do it. But we can do other things to make sure, you know, that they're evaluated, and that there's a way to evaluate to make sure that every industry that comes in and takes advantage of those incentive plans are actually good corporate citizens, and that they are reinvesting and making sure that they're actually making sure that Alabama is truly and indeed the beneficiary. You know, one of our concerns is the fact that a lot of the industries are hiring temps, you know, working, the temps are working extreme hours. I think we need to evaluate that as well, you know, and see, you know, once they're here and taking advantage of the incentives, how are they treating their workers? That's an important piece of information that we need in order to evaluate whether or not those incentives remain.
According to a U.S. News report, Alabama remains at or near the bottom for employment, 48th in the nation, labor force participation and job growth. While income levels have risen, they've remained below the national average. So first part of the question is, what is your plan to improve income at all economic levels?
I'm about to sound like a broken record, but I'm going to risk that, Ian. When I'm elected governor, I'm going to present to the legislature a plan called the Lifelong Learner Lottery. That $300 million a year, that right now, a lot of that money is going out of state right now to Georgia, Tennessee, and Florida, and some of it with far as just gambling dollars to Mississippi. We're going to do a much better job keeping that money in Alabama through the creation of the Lifelong Learner Lottery. How I believe that this money should be spent is really in three major ways. One, that it would fully fund K-4, and that we would offer $30 to $35 million in a sliding scale for child care, 0 to 3. It'd be the largest increase in dollars into 0 to 4 education and child care ever in the history of the state of Alabama. It's going to prepare kids to be able to be successful when they get to first grade. That's the first prong. The second prong is really more to your question, and that is its workforce development. Right now, Alabama is only meeting 50% of the workforce development needs. Only 50%. When I become governor and we push the legislature to do the right thing and do what the people want and pass the lottery, that Lifelong Learner Lottery proceeds, $50 million a year, will go to fully fund career tech. What that's going to mean is that we will be maxing out our workforce development needs. What it also means is that recidivism will drop, crime will go down, because it's kids 16, 17, 18 that are drop out of school, don't have a job, that are really getting in trouble. What is it going to mean for industry? It's going to mean for the state of Alabama and economics. It's going to mean that 100,000 people that's moving, that's just driving, commuting into Alabama to fill our jobs that require highly skilled workers, those jobs will now be filled by Alabamians, because we will be giving them the skills that they need to be able to be these well-paid employees. The third prong is the gap in Pell Grants. So we're going to use the Lifelong Learner Lottery to help those 18-year-olds that perhaps they got certified as a sheet welder, now they're going to go on and be a robotics welder or be a pipe welder. Maybe it's a 50-year-old that's lost their job. Now they can go back and be retrained in computers or some type of equipment or an LPN or something of that nature. So what we'll be doing there, literally, is helping someone who's lost their job or been disabled to be able to go back and be retrained. If they qualify for a Pell Grant, under my plan, they would go to school for free. So that's 2-year, that's tech schools, and that's also 4-year, 4-year college and university. And if there's any money left over, which I'm not absolutely sure it will, I have a plan that I hope that it will go toward giving people an opportunity to do certain community service work and work off their school loans or student debt.
Sorry,
what I was going to say, the industries, our problem right now is that we literally do not have the workers that have got the skills to be able to attract 21st century jobs. I know that I've had law firms tell me, one large law firm here in Birmingham that told me they lost a large client because they came in and did a workforce survey and realized that there weren't people here that could repair the robots that they were going to put online for this particular business. With the Lifelong Learner Lottery, maxing out on career tech as well as the gap in Pell Grants, because you know, to do the high skill jobs, you're not ready and able and prepared to do those jobs when you graduate from high school. You're going to have to go on. So every child in Alabama is going to be able to go on for an additional 2 years and get that specialized, particularly high-skilled training, to have the kind of jobs that will pull down significant salaries so that they can do the things that they want to do for their families. They'll be able to go on vacations, buy new new cars, buy homes, you know, be able to invest, put money in savings, actually have the kind of life and quality of life that other states are having. You know, we're 48th. Why are we 48th? Why are our president-elected officials not talking about the fact we're 48th? Because they're unwilling to tell the people of Alabama what they should hear. They only want to tell them what they just want them to hear, because they have not been focusing on the significant issues. Quality education leads to quality jobs. With the Lifelong Learner Lottery, we are going to be able to provide that quality education, both traditional academics as well as vocational training.
You may have touched on this, but want to ask, what does the state need to invest in to improve jobs in the state of all residents so they have an opportunity to improve their quality of life?
I've answered it, but I'll try it again. All of us know we need to fully fund career tech and vocational education. I mean, that's just clear. But the question is that the folks that are running, the other individuals and candidates are running, are not offering a reason. A way to fund it. I'm offering a way to fund it. It's the Lifelong Learner Lottery. If we spend the money like I'm indicating and proposing that it be spent, we will have the money to fully fund all career tech. Now, what we need to do is ramp up dual enrollment so that we have so if you're in a community like where there's a vocational school, that perhaps that will be the place where we will put most of the new equipment, the additional professors and instructors, and then we will bus in kids from the high schools to take advantage of that. That way, adults that are being retrained, you know, can take advantage of it, as well as high schoolers. But if you're in a community where there's not ready access to a two-year or vocational school, then obviously we're going to want to put that equipment there at that high school. So dual enrollment is going to be huge. It's going to save money, it's going to save time, and it's going to help our kids and all of our workers be able to take on those 21st century jobs.
In the last 12 to 24 months, Alabama has set records in heat, cold, flooding, and drought. What is your stance on climate change?
Well, I believe in science. I believe in science. I think that one of the most disturbing trends that we've had is that we have not had policymakers actually accept and understand science. And we know, being in the Gulf Coast, being in Alabama at the Gulf Coast, that we have been the victim and received our share of hurricanes and other storms. So we clearly, that's not something, you know, Mark Twain said, everybody complains about the weather, but nobody does anything about it. We know that there are some things that we can do. And to be good conservationists of the resources that the good Lord has given us, we've got to do that. But let me tell you something else we haven't done. In Alabama, we have not come upon where the present administration is also not doing anything about water quality and quantity. So you mentioned droughts. We know that right now we've had plenty of rain, haven't we? I mean, we've had lots of rain of late. But we know that the drought is coming. You know, it's all cyclical. We know that. And we know that it appears that it's going to be increasingly severe. We have got the present administration and the past several governors have ignored a water management plan. And the present administration and legislature have zeroed out water quality enforcement dollars. When Democrats were in control, there were $6.5 million for water quality enforcement with the Alabama Department of Environmental Management. Now there's zero. Alabama has some of the most toxic drinking water in the nation. So we know that the severe changes in the climate also have an impact, you know, on water quality. Because, you know, if pollution's there and the water quality goes down, then that water's more toxic. So we need to approach it also from a water quality, because, you know, that's a bipartisan or either nonpartisan issue. Everybody wants clean water. I mean, water is essential to life. Clean water is imperative. And right now we have communities in Alabama, and the present administration is not addressing this issue. We have communities in Alabama that have more toxic drinking water than Flint, Michigan. The people need to know.
What about auto emissions? Should the state institute an auto emissions requirement on all vehicles?
You know, I'm not sure. I know that nationally that it would appear that nationally that those standards, you know, have increased and have improved. I know that other states do have more stringent standards, and that's something I certainly would look at, but I'd want to talk. Alabama has done a remarkable job in recruiting the automotive manufacturing industry to Alabama, and I'd love to sit down with the auto manufacturers and discuss that issue and see if there's anything else that the state of Alabama could do that would improve on what the federal position is.
Education is another big topic that we're going to be talking about a lot. The state recently released a grade of C for state schools. Educational improvement has long been seen as a linchpin for state growth. First of all, what is your plan for improving schools across the state of Alabama?
I'm proposing the lifelong learner lottery. Alabamians want a lottery. They just think it's dumb. We don't have one. The problem has been the very special interests like Mississippi Gaming and others that have been obstacles to its passage in the past. We need a governor. We need a governor that would champion the lottery. The lottery would produce $300 million a year. All of that money would benefit education from zero to universities. The money, if it's spent like I'm proposing, would fully fund K-4. We're only meeting 28% of the kindergarten four-year-old need. And you know, that's one of the big problems. Teachers will tell you right now, I had a superintendent tell me last night, you know, that they literally have children that come to school in some schools in Alabama that do not know how to hold a book. I mean, literally the book will be upside down. They will not know how to turn the pages because unfortunately we have many homes in Alabama that there's not a book. There's not a magazine. We need to address that for sure. There's a way to do that by making sure that we fully fund child care and four-year-old kindergarten. You give kids an opportunity to learn early while their brains are developing. They are going to be successful when they get to first grade. You cannot be a success if you're not cannot read. Alabama presently, our present administration and the folks in Montgomery will say, oh, we've got the best Alabama Reading Initiative program in the United States. And it is supposed to be and is been determined to be an excellent program. What they fail to tell you is that it's only being given to 10% of the children that need it. So we have many struggling readers in Alabama, Alabama children, Alabama schools that teachers are dealing with, and we're not giving them the training or the resources. So they're the teachers, you know, are working very hard to try to help, you know, do the education that should have been done in those early years, and we know that that's the best place for it. So that's number one. We've got to fully fund pre-K and help on a sliding scale with child care. The second thing is funding, of course, the reading initiative. The other thing that we've got to do, as I mentioned with a lifelong learning lottery, is to fully fund vocational or career tech. When we do that, we're taking a lot of kids out of the more traditional academic settings where they're not really appropriate, and that's not where their talents are. They're making the choice. I want to go the vocational educational route. I want a skill. You know, I'd rather work with my hands. That's where my talents are. And with fully funding the vocational and career tech, we're going to be helping the other classes because we're going to be adding $50 million with instructors that will have state-of-the-art equipment that will help prepare our kids, you know, for those high-skill 21st century jobs. Now, let me say this. That's not an end-all be-all. You know, we know the lottery is not, but we also know that if we spend the money like I'm talking about spending it, that it is going to create thousands of teacher assistant, support personnel, career tech jobs, not to mention the industry that's going to come into Alabama because we know we're going to be meeting our workforce development requirements. With that, because of that, all of that money is going to be extra money in young families' hands that they were paying on child care. Now they can fix that car. They can buy a new car. They can buy a house. I mean, they can take a vacation. All that money turns and is going to have a positive impact on our economy. That is money that's taxed without raising taxes. That's extra revenue from those extra jobs, those higher incomes, that's going to be going into the Education Trust Fund. When we have that additional money in the Education Trust Fund, we're going to have the additional monies. I hope to have social workers and counselors in school. We know that back again to school safety. what we don't have in Alabama is we don't have the qualified personnel that actually can work with children that have got emotionally conflicted, I have mental health or mental illness issues. So this extra money that would be going into education would help fund those positions as well. When you get those troubled kids out of the classroom, those that are causing the disturbance, what does that do for that classroom? It's creating an environment that's going to be much more conducive to learning, which is what we've got to have. Now, let me tell you the last thing is that I just think it's just flat wrong for Alabama teachers to make $4,000 to $5,000 on the average less than Georgia teachers. That's wrong. You know, so a lot of our best and brightest teachers are moving to other states. Others are staying and working like unbelievable dedication, but not being compensated the way that they should be compensated. I'm convinced with the lifelong learner lottery and the additional jobs that are going to be created, there'll be additional revenue that will go into the education trust fund. And when we do that, that's going to provide the source for the pay increases that our teachers deserve, and the additional training dollars that will benefit our every student in a classroom. It also will have an impact on class size. We know that class size is extremely important on determining what the success of a classroom, an individual in a classroom is. With those additional dollars from the Lifelong Learner Lottery and the jobs that are created, those dollars are going to go and help, I hope, reduce class size in Alabama.
You touched on this, but just want to ask it as well. Does Alabama need to spend more on education, and what would you want to see that spent on?
Alabama absolutely must spend more. We're lagging behind other states, and we've got to fix it. With the Lifelong Learner Lottery, I'm convinced we can fix it. As I've outlined previously, the money would go for pre-K. It would go for 0 to 3 childcare on a sliding scale, career tech. And the additional dollars that would come from all of the extra pay and salary increases that are going to come as a result of that, of those skilled workers getting those jobs, the industry coming in, are going to go for education. And as I mentioned earlier, we'll go for programs like reducing class size, early reading initiative to help all struggling readers. I hope it will help enhance equipment so that, you know, that we really can do more with math and science. We can help the other extracurricular activities that we know are important. You know, the Y has got a wonderful program called Youth Judicial, you know, where children learn more about government. I'm convinced, you know, that we need a day in every single one of our schools that we really do focus on the Constitution and our system of government. I mean, we have three branches of government, and you can do surveys and a lot of citizens cannot name the branches of government. You know, our democracy is unique. We're revered around the world. One of the things we must do in our schools is make sure that all students, when they leave, you know, truly do understand our democracy and how we preserve it.
Recently, there was a federal court denied the request of a Birmingham suburb to start its own school system. The reason for that decision was based on race. Do you think Alabama's educational system is racially inequitable?
I know one thing for sure. We know that there is inequity with the way our schools are funded. You know, there's a law that requires a certain amount of millage, you know, in every county, in every school system. But we know that 1 mill in Lowndes County or 1 mill in Sumter County does not produce what 1 mill in the Vestavia or Mountain Brook school system produces. So we know that there's inequity of funding. I believe that there should be a constitutional right to public education. We cannot exist without well-funded, quality public education. So I definitely think, as governor, I would like to provide leadership on this issue. As the governor, I'm a member of the state school board and the chair of the state school board. I pledge to people that I will do everything humanly possible to be at every state school board meeting so that I will have a direct and immediate impact on policy and the development of proper policy in Alabama. And one of those things will be, and one of those issues is the proper and equitable funding of our schools.
So what do you think should be done to make the system fair for all?
I think we've got to address how schools are funded, and I disagree with how they're funded to date. I disagree with the recent case that had to do with the issue that was dispositive of the issue on equity funding. I believe that we have a right to public education. I want to make sure that it's clear that we have a right to public education, and when you have a clear statutory constitutional right to public education, then the legislature's duty bound to make sure that all schools are supported and funded equally.
Last summer, there was a fight that began in Birmingham over a Civil War statue in the city's Elden Park. The city erected a wooden wall around the bottom of the monument to block the inscription. There was a suit filed against the move. The state also passed a law that would prevent the removal of any Civil War statue or monument. Alabama is a state known as the battleground for race relations. Where do you think Alabama stands with race relations today?
I'm very concerned about where we stand on race relations. As a child advocate, I can tell you, I believe a rising tide raises all ships unless they're anchored down. And we have a lot of negative public policy and inferior public policy that does not stand up in comparison to other states, where we are not taking care of and meeting the needs of needy children and families. I think a lot of that has to do, I hate to say it, but I really do think a lot of that has to do with a lot of race-based efforts on the part of folks that are in the legislature and other leaders. I truly believe that God has no favorites, you know, that our Heavenly Father loves us all equally. And I believe that a governor should set, you know, leadership starts on top, and that the governor needs to set the stage and for conversation on these issues, to challenge all leaders, to challenge all businesses, to challenge everybody in authority, to examine themselves to determine exactly what they're saying and doing and how it might reflect on those who are not Caucasian. Alabama's a beautiful state, has beautiful, kind-hearted, determined people. We need to be challenged, each of us, to look and see, are there any biases? Do we have biases? And why? And realize that we truly are all created equal. And when we believe that, and when we eternalize that, we are going to have a better state.
What should the state do to make improvements?
I don't think you mandate it. I mean, how do you mandate it? There's not a law. I believe that the governor has to set the stage, and I think that what I would love to do is I would like to have a governor's conference on the clergy and race relations, or the clergy and racial divide, because I think all of our clergy should take on a more meaningful, outspoken, bold role on challenging their congregants, challenging the members of their church about what the Bible says about how we're supposed to treat others. You know, our Bible, the Old and the New, and every faith, you know, love and care and consideration and kindness toward others is a basic precept of every faith. The governor needs to exemplify that. The governor needs to set a leadership and take a leadership role in making sure that this discussion, that we have this discussion. You know, I was very honored that when I retired as Chief Justice after wearing a robe for 30 years and making those difficult decisions over people's lives, the circuit judges gave me a mirror. And they said to me, we're giving you this mirror because as Chief Justice, you constantly put a mirror before our eyes and made us look at ourselves. That's what the governor should do. I wanted the judges to treat everyone with dignity. That's what I asked. Because, you know, when you come into a courtroom, you know, you may know that the result is not going to work out necessarily like you want, but you want your day in court. You want to be treated with fairness and dignity, and you want to have your say. And most people, once they've been treated with fairness and dignity and have their say, they can come to terms with that, whatever that result was. But the key is treating people with equal justice, with dignity and fairness. And that's what the governor should do. We need a governor in Alabama that basically challenges the entire state. Let's look at ourselves. Let's see what we're doing. Are we contributing? Are we part of that problem? Are we part of the solution? And then encourage discussion. So my plan truly is to address the issue, to provide leadership on the issue, with sincerity, with passion, with authenticity, and encourage all leaders in the individual and respective communities to do the same.
Last couple questions are about elections. There was a recent NBC News report that was released in February. NBC learned that U.S. intelligence officials had evidence that seven states had their election systems compromised by Russia before or during the 2016 presidential race. Are you concerned about meddling in our elections?
I am concerned about meddling, and I know that Alabama was one of the states. I'm almost positive, isn't that correct?
I believe they looked.
They looked.
They tried.
They tried, right. Alabama was one of the states that they tried to hack into, and I'm glad to hear that we seem to think that they did not. But the most important right that we have is the right and privilege of voting. And to have a country such as Russia have some possible negative impact on that through social media or otherwise is disturbing. Our campaign, our websites, our accounts, we already know there's been over 1,000 attempts to hack us. We know that happens, and right now we feel very secure. But because all of us have now, everything is now, based on our website, based on internet, based on email, and all the things that we've got to be very careful. And I know as a state we need to do more, because I know there's small businesses and others that don't have the funds, to protect themselves. But we've got to make sure that our voter files are protected. And that we know that we're doing what we need to do to make sure that our elections are free from any possible wrongful meddling.
What do you think, what would you want to see done to make sure that doesn't happen, to keep that from happening?
Well, as far as I understand, and anyone could correct me on this, because I'm certainly no computer IT guru, it really is protection. We've got to have the resources to make sure that we're protecting, our systems. And I think that, I know that when I was Chief Justice, I actually hired a very premier forensic computer analyst, to attempt to hack into our system. So I know that there's things like that we need to do. We need to hire individuals to see, are we safe? And hire them and employ them to see what can be done and see if we truly are safe. I was very pleased to tell you that, after we corrected things that this expert found, we corrected those things, and then our data. And when I was Chief Justice, I oversaw e-filing and the implementation of an integrated e-filing system through a private-public partnership. And as a result of that, what we've done truly, is to, without state dollars, go paperless and make our documents much more accessible. And what's happened is that we've saved the taxpayers millions and millions of dollars.
Alabama does not offer early voting, while several other states do offer early voting. Would you like to see that changed?
I'd absolutely like to see it change. Voting should be easier, not harder. People should not have to take off work to vote. I would love to see us have early voting. Some states even have voting, where you literally, have multiple days, like 3 weeks every day. Other states, the day to vote is on the weekend. Some it's even on Sunday. But if we have multiple days for voting, it's going to be a good thing, because people, it is a privilege, it's a right. We should make it easier for people to vote. We don't want voter fraud, but there's really been few instances of voter fraud, very few. What we want is to make voting easier.
So you would support implementing early voting?
Yes, absolutely.